if you haven't seen part one on the tag team championships yet, check it out. Now on to part two. And I didn't think I'd be talking about this until the end of the series, but due to the numbers, I get to talk about it second. So part two of four, the World Championship. Whether it's the namesake title, the big gold belt, that silver thing, or the red piece of shit, the world title is a big deal. And the namesake title, more important than the others at times, regardless, the world title is a big deal. And the World Championship at SummerSlam has always been a big deal. Even if it didn't always change hands, the World Championship at SummerSlam has always been a big deal. In the 29 previous SummerSlams, there has been a new world champion, whether the WWF WWE Championship, the World Heavyweight Championship, the 1 year of the WCW Championship, the few years of the ECW Championship, and now the Universal Championship. In the 29 previous SummerSlams, a world championship has changed hands 12 times. Now, this isn't like the tag team championship where it was not defended more than defended, because there has been at least one world championship match at SummerSlam at every SummerSlam except for three: 1988, 1989, and 1991. Now, the first world championship change at a SummerSlam, yeah, that one took a while. 1997, Bret Hart defeated The Undertaker with Shawn Michaels as the special guest referee. So many historical notes here. First, it was the first time that a world championship changed hands at a SummerSlam. Yeah, that's right. It took until the 10th SummerSlam for one to happen. 1988, 1989, and 1991, Randy Savage and Hulk Hogan respectively took part in tag team main events as the WWF champion. Ultimate Warrior retained in 1990, Randy Savage retained in 1992, Yokozuna retained in 1993, Bret Hart retained in 1994, Diesel retained in 1995, and Shawn Michaels retained in 1996. The trend ended in 1997, Bret Hart defeated The Undertaker for the WWF Championship, and with that win, Bret Hart won his fifth WWF Championship, becoming only the second man in the history of the company to do so, and since that point, only five other wrestlers have accomplished at least five WWF/WWE Championships, not counting the big gold belt in that. And finally, Bret Hart became the only wrestler in SummerSlam history to win the Triple Crown at SummerSlam. He won the Tag Team Championships in 1990, he won the Intercontinental Championship in 1991, and he won the World Championship in 1997. This was the title change that set the course for the WWF over the next 90-some-odd days, which culminated in the thing that set the course for the WWF over the next few years. It was a big match, it was a big moment, and you had a huge outcome with the first world championship change at a SummerSlam. Now, after a one-year drought, Steve Austin retained in 1998, the WWF Championship changed hands in 1999 amid a bit of controversy. Mankind defeated Steve Austin and Triple H in a triple threat match with Jesse the Body Ventura as the special guest referee. Now, I said this one had a bit of controversy. Amongst all the world championship changes in SummerSlam history, this one is the most controversial. Now, first off, Jesse Ventura being the special guest referee, hell, Jesse Ventura doing anything with the WWF again, it was one of those hell freezes over moments, especially if you know the bad blood he and Vince McMahon had throughout the decade of the 90s. And then you had the fact that he was the governor of Minnesota at that time. Minnesota was the home of SummerSlam 1999. That added a bit of controversy in the political world. Second off, the many different changes to this match is proof that shit changing week to week isn't just a current problem, it's been a problem going back for years. Originally, this was supposed to be Steve Austin versus Triple H. Then it was Steve Austin versus China. And then, because reasons, we get a triple threat match between Steve Austin, Triple H, and Mankind. Now, third off, the finish. originally it was going to be Triple H defeating Austin for the championship. And then when they switched to Austin versus China for a bit, there was a brief period of time they were actually going to have China defeat Steve Austin for the WWF championship. And then when they went to the triple threat, we ended up with Mankind winning the WWF Championship. Now, there have been so many stories over the years. So, long story short, Triple H was supposed to win. Circumstances happened, and Mankind ended up with the WWF Championship for 24 hours. We had another one-year drought. Rock retained in 2000, and the WWF Championship was retained in 2001. However, there was a second world championship at this time, the WCW Championship, and that championship did change hands when The Rock defeated Booker T. Oh boy, the invasion angle. It was during this time, and I don't know if I've said this already, but fuck the invasion. Now, off subject, if I was to make a shirt that said, fuck the invasion, would you people buy it? Hell, if I made shirts, period, would you people buy them? Back onto subject. Anyways, Rock returned from making a movie. He chose WWF over the Alliance. We ended up with Rock Booker T. The fact it main evented over Austin Angle was shocking because it was the WCW Championship. But anyways, We all knew what was going to happen. Rock was going to win the championship. It happened. The match was okay. And, well, fuck the invasion. No one-year drought this time and no second world championship. Only one world championship for just about another month. But anyways, 2002, Brock Lesnar defeated The Rock. Now, this one was very noteworthy, as with the win here, Brock Lesnar became the youngest world champion in WWE history, and as far as the namesake title goes, the WWF / WWE Championship, hell, it was the WWWF Championship, the namesake title, the one with the lineage that goes back to 1963. Brock Lesnar is still the youngest title holder as of this recording. Now, Brock got the rocket push. He debuted the night after WrestleMania 18. He won King of the Ring, and in the process earned a shot at the WWE title, and just for good measure, he beat Hulk Hogan with a bear hug on SmackDown. I love the build for this match. I love this match, period. It was one of the best matches in SummerSlam history, one of the best main events in SummerSlam history. And this is a template for How to Make a Star 101. Back to the one-year drought and back to two world championships again. Both the WWE and World Heavyweight Championships were retained in 2003, and the WWE Championship was retained in 2004. However, the World Heavyweight Championship wasn't, as Randy Orton defeated Chris Benoit. And unfortunately, this moment, it isn't celebrated like it should be, and really, it can never happen again. I mean, with this win here, Randy Orton became the youngest world champion in WWE history, and it's a distinction he still holds to this very day, and it's really unlikely that it will ever be broken. But unfortunately, the moment here at SummerSlam, it isn't celebrated. It can never be celebrated again, and it's because of the Benoit incident in 2007. That's the reason it can't be. Orton won a battle royal on Raw to become number one contender. After Benoit retained in the Iron Man match, Orton Benoit was confirmed for SummerSlam. The match was great. Orton winning with a true RKO out of nowhere was amazing. Benoit made him look like $1 million on this night. But again, it's unfortunate that we can't celebrate this, and WWE can't truly celebrate this anymore, except for the fact of, hey, Randy Orton's the youngest world champion in WWE history. Now, aside from the 9-year drought to start off with, this drought here was the longest between world title changes. Between 2005 and 2008, there were no world title changes, and starting in 2006, there were 3 world titles now, with the ECW Championship being added to the mix. And in 2009, the ECW Championship was retained, the WWE Championship was retained. However, CM Punk ended the world title drought by winning the World Heavyweight Championship from Jeff Hardy in a tables, ladders, and chairs match. The Punk-Hardy feud was the feud in WWE during the summer of 2009. Looking back, because, you know, John Cena, Randy Orton was for the WWE Championship and it was on this card, I'm shocked WWE put CM Punk versus Jeff Hardy last. Ultimately, it was the right call in putting Punk-Hardy last because this match was amazing. The feud was great. Punk winning was great. Not much more to say here. We had another one-year drought. Both the WWE and World Heavyweight Championships were retained in 2010. There's no more ECW Championship. It's back to two World Championships. 2011, Randy Orton defeated Christian in a no-holds-barred match for the World Heavyweight Championship. With this win here, Randy Orton became the first wrestler in SummerSlam history to win a World Championship twice at SummerSlam, and this one, again, like I said, was against Christian. This was SmackDown's top feud throughout the spring into the summer of 2011. Christian won the title at Extreme Rules, he lost it two nights later, regained it at Money in the Bank, and here was their second-to-last match, a no-holds-barred match. It was a really good match, Randy Orton won, let's move on. But not only did the World Heavyweight Championship change hands at SummerSlam 2011, but the WWE Championship changed hands as well, making it the only time during this period where it was both the WWE and World Heavyweight Championship, where both the WWE and World Heavyweight Championships changed hands at SummerSlam. And this was also the first time the Money in the Bank briefcase was cashed in at SummerSlam as well, because Alberto Del Rio defeated CM Punk in this Money in the Bank cash-in. I mean, not only did they ruin the Summer of Punk angle by bringing Punk back too soon, they did this as well. After Punk defeated John Cena to become the quote-unquote undisputed WWE champion, Kevin Nash jackknifes Punk, Alberto cashes in, he becomes the new WWE champion. This was horrible. I mean, Del Rio cashing in would have been fine had he not... He could have cashed in on anybody else, but having him cash in on Punk, I mean, they ruined the angle. But this here was the end of the hottest angle in years. It was horrible. 2012 was another year where both world championships didn't change hands. The World Heavyweight Championship in 2013 was retained in its final SummerSlam. However, the WWE Championship, it not only changed hands once during SummerSlam 2013, it changed hands twice during SummerSlam 2013. Daniel Bryan defeated John Cena with Triple H as the special guest referee, and then Randy Orton defeated Daniel Bryan in a Money in the Bank cash-in with Triple H as the special guest referee. Now, the story between Bryan and Cena was a really good story. However, I think most of us believed Cena was going to end up winning in the end. However, due to an injury, Cena needed time off. He needed to get rid of the belt. And thus, Daniel Bryan defeated John Cena with the running knee clean to win the WWE Championship. Post-match saw Triple H turn heel, Randy Orton turn heel, and Randy Orton cashing in his Money in the Bank briefcase to win the WWE Championship. And it was the start of a huge story that, with the fans kicking and screaming, the WWE was reluctant to finish at WrestleMania 30. Also, Randy Orton became the only wrestler to win a world championship at SummerSlam on three different occasions. 2014, there's one world championship again, the WWE World Heavyweight Championship, and here, Brock Lesnar defeated John Cena. Now, defeating, it's the nice way of saying it, because Brock Lesnar annihilated John Cena. This was essentially a 16-minute squash match, as Cena got in maybe one or two pieces of offense in. Other than that, it was all Brock Lesnar. And it was this match that inadvertently turned Brock into the biggest babyface in the company, because had Daniel Bryan not went down with an injury, we probably would have gotten Lesnar-Bryan at SummerSlam, and Bryan would have been obliterated by Brock Lesnar, and Brock would have gotten more heat added to him. I mean, you add him ending The Undertaker's undefeated streak at WrestleMania to obliterating the underdog WWE champion at SummerSlam, you got the biggest heel WWE has seen in many, 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 many years. However, it went the way it went. I mean, what else can we say? The WWE World Heavyweight Championship was retained in 2015, but by the time we get to the following year, 2016, we once again had two world titles, the WWE World Championship and the newly created WWE Universal Championship. The WWE World Championship was retained in 2016. However, when it comes to the Universal Championship, we were guaranteed to have a title change, as the winner of the match was going to be crowned the first ever Universal Champion. That was Finn Balor defeating Seth Rollins. Seth got a bye to SummerSlam, and Balor won his Fatal 4-Way and defeated Roman Reigns to make it to SummerSlam. Now, unfortunately, it was probably going to be the beginning of something, but we'll never know what it was, though, because this win was really all for nothing, as Finn Balor had to vacate the Universal title the following night due to an injury. He injured his shoulder during the match against Rollins. Share your thoughts in the comments section below. What was your favorite World Championship change in SummerSlam history? Check out Part 1 if you haven't already, and stay tuned for Part 3. Until next time, peace.